Welcome back to my class. Today in this class we shall start up with a new module called as Basic Processing Unit. So as we have already known, a computer system will be having one fundamental unit which will be responsible for carrying out the execution or the operation of the instructions or the machine instruction that will be given to a computer system. So that functional unit will be coordinating and communicating the activities with the other subsystems within the computer, isn't it? So that fundamental, that unit will be called it as, you are already known as central processing unit, isn't it? So it might be also referred to as instruction set processor. ISP is nothing but an instruction set processor, or simply you can call it as an processor. So in this chapter, what you will be going to learn is, you will be going to learn the internal organization of the processor, and also what you will be going to learn is how it will be performing the its basic fundamental task. What is the basic fundamental task of a processor? That is, it will be fetching the instruction. Very first, it will be carrying out the fetching of the instructions that is been given to a computer system, and next it will be decoding it, isn't it? So it will be decoding the instruction, and the last and final phase, it will be executing, isn't it? So these are the three main steps that will be carried out by your instruction set processor or a processor. So in this chapter, in your module 1, what you were studied, that is the basic functional units that were present in your computer system and how the organizations were carried out. And next, in the upcoming modules, you go on and studied with the input and output devices, how the input and output devices that is been connected to your computer system, how the internal organization is being done, how the instruction is being sent from an input device, and how the result has been displayed in your output devices, and how the speed of synchronization is being achieved between your input and output unit. These are all the things that you had been studied. Next, in the upcoming modules also, you had studied in detail about the memory system, how the internal organization will be done in your memory system, how the operations is being carried out, how the data will be stored, and how you will be retrieving the data. These are all the things you had came across with, isn't it? So next, in now in this module or in this chapter, you will be going to learn about your fundamental unit of your computer system, that is your central processing unit. So how this internal organization of the CPU is being done, and how it is going to perform its basic fundamental steps, that is your fetching an instruction, decoding an instruction, and finally how it going to execute an instruction to get an appropriate result. Fine. So before going to the internal organization, or before going up into the processor functions, let us know some of the fundamental concepts of a processor. So what is the fundamental concept? You are already known, that is, always the memory will, the processor will be keep track the memory locations of the address that will be fetched for the next instruction that is going to be executed, isn't it? So always the next instruction which is being going to be executed, that will be stored in a dedicated register called as program counter, isn't it? So these are the things which you have been already studied in your previous modules. So this program counters will be always pointing to the address of the next instruction to be gets executed. So the processor will always have the track of the memory locations of the next instruction to be get executed. So that is why from the PC you will be loading the contents into a special purpose register called as IR. What do you mean by IR? That is your instruction register. So, what is the things you will be carrying out in your instruction register? What the actions that is being stated to perform in the instruction? Whether it might, the operation might be an add operation, or the operation that need to be carried out is an subtract operation. Whatever the actions that is being specified in an instruction to carry out, that action will be carried out in your special purpose register, that is your instruction register, which will be always symbolically stated as IR. Fine. So, very first step that you will be carrying out in your execution of your processor is the loading the contents of an PC to an IR. Fine. And the next step what you will be going to carry out is PC will be incremented to next address or memory location. Since it is in the memory will be an byte addressable, to point to next word in your memory location, I will be adding the constant 4. So, why constant 4 is being added? Because your memory location or your memory system is might be an byte addressable. So, if it is a byte addressable, to point out to a next word in your memory location, always the PC contents will be added by a constant value 4. So, these are the steps you have already known, but before going to the actual execution which has been done by a processor, let's memorize the actual fundamental steps that is been going to carried out. So, after fetching the or after incrementing your PC to point to the next instruction to be get executed, next actually you will be going to carry out the action which is been specified by an instruction, that is you will be stored in your IR and that instruction will be gets executed. Fine. So, whatever the steps which I have been written here, the first two steps will be called it as fetch phase. So, and the third step you will be calling it as an execution phase. Fine. So, the instruction which is being need to get executed will be going through two phases, that is your fetch phase and your execution phase. If your instruction consisting of two or more words, means your first two steps will be continuous until your complete instruction is been get fetched out. Next only you will be moving on to the execution phase. If your instruction is being fitted out in only one word of your memory, means you will be carried only once these two steps and you will be going out to the execution phase. If your complete instruction occupies more than two words, means you will be repeating these two steps until your complete instruction got been fetched, and then you will be moving on to the next phase, that is your execution phase. Fine. This is the fundamental steps that you will be followed before you will be going to fetch execute an instruction. So, these are the fundamental concepts that you need to know about the processor organization. So, now let us look how the internal organization of the processor is being done, how the organization is being made, how the other fundamental units or other subsystems has been got connected, how the register has been connected to the processor. These are all the things we will be going now. So, this is will be a single bus which will be connected to all the units of that is being gets attached to a processor. So, this is an internal organization, means this will be considered as a simple single bus will gets connected all its units. So, your PC is nothing but your program counter which will be always pointing to the address of the next instruction to be gets fetched out. Fine. So, next will be your MAR. So, what do you mean by an MAR? As you are already known, MAR is nothing but a memory address register. Fine. Next, it will gets connected with MDR. MDR is nothing but your memory data register. So where the MAR will be storing the address of the register, where MDR will be storing the data that is being stored in a particular address, which has been sent by an MAR. Fine. And now you will be having another register called as Y. You will be going to learn why this register is being used. Okay. And you also have an MUX multiplexer, and also you will be gets connected to an ALU. So now you will be gets connected with an ALU, and also you will be having an another register called as Y. So you will get to know why these registers are being used now when I get going to explain the concept. Fine. So again you will be having in another register called as temp, and also you will be using the N general purpose registers. Fine. So this is the single bus organization of an processor. Fine. So as the figure that has been depicted, this shows the simple organization of a processor that will be gets connected to ALU, and all the other units will be gets connected to a single bus. Fine. So it will be consisting of an multiplexer called as MUX, which will be sending the value, or the input of the MUX will be given by an register Y, and also you will be having an constant value called as 4. So why you will be using this constant value 4? Because while explaining the fundamental concept, as I already told you, since it is a byte addressable memory, if you need to point to a next word of your memory, you will be incrementing by a constant value called as 4, isn't it? So next, the MUX will be gets input, and the input to an ALU will be followed by the output of an MUX, whereas the other input will be given by the internal bus of a processor. So these two operands will be fed to your ALU, that is your arithmetic logic unit, where the actual execution gets takes place and it will be sent to an register Z. And also you will be having your MAR and MDR. So as you already known, MAR is nothing but the address lines, whereas MDR will is nothing but an data lines of your memory bus. So the address where the address lines will be the address or will be sent by the processor through the processor bus, whereas the data lines that can be traversed both through the memory bus and to your internal processor bus. And the control signals for these memory bus is being sent by the instruction decoder and control logic. This unit is responsible for issuing the control signals to all the units, and also it will be coordinating the operations that need to be carried out by each and every unit. It might be your MAR, MDR, MUX, ALU, and also the three registers which will be called it as Y, Z and your temp registers. So this Y, Z and temp registers are transparent to a program and it is not directly referred in your instructions. So it will be not directly referred in your instruction, but these registers will be used by a processor for an temporal storage. Fine. So for what purpose you will be using these registers means you will be using as a temporary storage by an processor, whereas these registers will not be directly referred by an instruction. Fine. So this is how the organization of an processor which will be made internally when executing an instruction. So your internal organization will be gets connected, or you will be using an single bus, internal processor bus, where all the units will be gets connected to your internal processor bus. So MAR and MDR, so the address to an MAR will be sent by the internal processor bus, which will be sent to the memory bus. So in the memory itself you need to find the address of the particular location which is been sent by the processor, isn't it? So next, after fetching the data which is been sent in a particular address, that data need to fetch back to your MDR. So from MDR again you will be placing that data into your processor bus to feed it to the execution. And again you will be using three more registers, that is Y, Z and temp. So in your Y register, whatever the data which has been sent by MDR, you will be placing in your processor bus. From processor bus again you may send it to Y register. So this data will be sent to a multiplexer which will be fed as an input to the ALU. Another input will be directly sent by an processor where the actual operation will be carrying out. So the control signals for all these unit will be sent and coordinated by an unit called as instruction decoder and control logic. Fine. So this unit is responsible for issuing the control signals to all the units which is being gets connected to your internal processor bus. Fine. So now you will be going to carry out the four main fundamental operations in your processor. So which are the main fundamental operations that you will be going to carry out? So very first is your, that is the transfer of data from one register to another register. So very first operation that you will be carry out is register transfer. Suppose if you want to send the data from register R1 to register R2, that might be one of the fundamental or main operations that you will be carrying out in your processor. And also you will be performing the arithmetic or logical operations. So arithmetic and logical operations that you need to be carried out, and also you will be carrying out the fetching the data, and the last one is storing the data. So fetching the data means fetching the data from one register or the from memory location, and you will be placing it on the bus. So bus or an register, that is your general purpose register. So what you will be doing, you will be fetching the contents from a particular address of your memory, and that data will be sent to another register, isn't it? So next is storing the data. So you will be storing the data from your bus to a particular memory location, which you will be using in another further operations. So these are the four basic steps, or these are the four basic sequences that you will be carrying out by your processor. So now let's go and look one by one how the operations will be carried out for these sequences, how the operations or what might be the instructions you will be carrying out or writing to have a registers transfer. So that is to convert or to send the data from one register to another register. So what is the sequence of steps you need to follow to perform an ALU operation? Again, what is the sequence of steps you need to follow the to perform or you to fetch an operate contents from the memory location to an register, again to store a contents to a particular memory location. So these are the four basic sequence, or these are the four basic steps you need to follow. So let's look at one by one. The very first is your register transfer. Yes, before going to learn up with the very first step, that is your register transfer, again you need to have slight modifications in your internal organization of a processor. The diagram which has been previously written, so you need to have some gating signals to the registers that you were using. So first let's look at upon how the gating signals will be used in every registers. Fine. Thank you. So, yes, now before going to learn about the first step, that is your registers transfer, first we need to know about your register gatings. So, as you already know, an execution of instruction involves sequence of steps that need to be followed. So, two control signals has been used to carry out the operation. The very first is one control signal is being used to fetch the data from the bus to an register, and also the other signal will be used to carry out the data from an register to load it onto the processor bus. Fine. So here you will be having an input and output register RI is being connected to a processor via switches, that is through two control signals, that is RI in and RI out. So you have two gating signals. So this will be called it as your gating signals. So here it's been symbolically marked as into mark or X. So it is nothing but it is gating to an particular register. So whatever the control signals you will be sending to an particular register, initially you will be gating it. So why you will be using a gating signal? So that you will be checking out whether an correct control signal is been reaching out to your particular register. Fine. So again, to your input and output register RI, you will be having two control signals, that is RI in and RI out. When RI in is set to 1, then you can traverse the data from an internal processor bus to your particular register. Or else if it is been set to 0, then no data can be transferred from the bus to your RI register. Similarly, your RI out, that is your output register, also gets worked out. So when I RI out is 1, you can send the data from the register RI to an processor bus. When it is been 0, so when RI out is 0, the data cannot be transferred from the register RI to your internal processor bus. So the same thing happens in your Y register as well as your Z registers. So every registers will be gated. So why? Because it to carry out an correct operation. So the control signals, whichever it is been reached to a particular registers, whether it is been an appropriate control signals, so that it will be checking out and then it will be reaching out its particular registers. Fine. So whatever the instructions that you will be executed by a processor, that is been calculated or that is been carried out within an defined interval of time, you will be defined it as processor clock. So always the execution of an instruction will be gets completed within a defined time interval. So this defined time interval will be calculated by an processor clock. So every register will be using an edge triggered flip-flop. If edge trigger flip-flop is not used, then two or more control signals, again it must be used to calculate an appropriate data transfer. So such type of using the more and more control signals, you will be calling it as multi-phase clocking or multi-phase decoding. Yes, it is multi-phase clocking. If the registers are not using an edge-triggered flip-flops, then again you need to use two or more control signals to send an appropriate data transfer. Such type of signaling or such type of data transfers, you will be calling it as multi-phase clocking. Fine. So these are some of the control signals and how the control signals will be gated out before it is reaching its particular registers. Fine. So now we shall look upon the very first sequence of operation, that is the register transfer. So here I am implementing an 1-bit transfer so that how the data is being carried out. So here I am using, and as I already told, every register will be using an edge triggered flip flop. Here is a RI register is using an edge triggered flip flop. When RI is 1, it will be carrying, or the data will be directly received by the bus. Or else if the RI in is 0, so the data will be feed back and it will be retaining the previous data that is being stored in the flip flop. Fine. Let us look upon how the first sequence event, that is register transfer, gets takes place. So here is an implementation of 1-bit transfer, that is of an RI register. It is being shown in an figure, the following figure. A 2 input MUX is being used, whereas an input is being given to by a processor and another input is being fed to an output to get a data that is being applied as an output of an edge triggered flip flop. So whenever RI is equal to 1, so you will be getting the data from your bus, that is your internal processor bus. When RI is equal to 0, it will be feeds back the data that is being currently stored in your flip flop. Fine. So when RI out is, so the output of an edge triggered flip flop is connected via a tri-state gate so that the data will be reaches again your bus. So when RI out is equal to 1, so the data will be in, the output will be in an I impedance state. So when the data RI out is 0, so it will be depending on the value of 1 and it will be changes the data that will be carried out over the bus. So suppose, for example, now let us take an example to transfer the data from register R1 to register R4. So whatever the data I have stored in the register R1, I need to traverse the data or the contents to register R4. So whatever the actions or whatever the mission instructions that I need to be carried out, as I already told, for every registers I will be having 2 control signals, that is your RI in and RI out. So very first what I need to carry out is, I need to enable the output of my register R1, isn't it? So I will be enabling the output of register R1, that is R1 out. Next, R1 out is equal to 1. Next, what I need to do? I need to transfer the contents of R1 to R4. So now what I need to enable in my R4 register, that is I need to input the data, that is which is being sent by my R1 register, isn't it? So now I will be enabling the input of my R4 register as 1, so that whatever the data which is being stored in R1 register, that will be transferred to my R4 register by enabling the input of my R4 register and output of my R1 register. So this is the sequence of operations that will be carried out, or this is the steps that you will be following to transfer the data from one register to another register by enabling its corresponding signals. So in my first step, I have enabled the output of my R1 register. In the second step, I have enabled the input of my are for registers to transfer the data from R1 to R4. Fine, understood? So this is how the operations of register transfer that takes place in a computer system. Fine. Of operation is your, that is the performing of arithmetic and logical operation. So how the arithmetic and logical operation is being carried out, so next we will be going to look on of it, how that arithmetic and logical operation will get performed. Fine. Yes, here is the sequence of steps that you need to follow to perform an arithmetic and logical operations. Yes, so let's look upon a simple example, that is add R1 comma R2. So this is what the action that is being specified in my instruction. So what are the steps I need to be followed? So very first is I need to fetch the instruction, isn't it? So very first, that is, as I already told, the execution of an instruction takes place in two phases. That is, the very first one is fetching phase, and the second one is your execution phase. So now I need to fetch the operands. So I am fetching the content, that is R1 out. So what the instruction is been stating here, add R1 comma R0. So I need to fetch the contents of R1 and R2. I need to perform an add operation. Next, I need to store the result in my R2 register. This is what the sequence of operation or sequence of steps I need to follow. First, I need to fetch the contents of R1. So what I am doing, I am fetching the contents of R1. So I am enabling the output of register R1. So I am enabling the output control signal of register R1. So I have written it as R1 out. Now I will be storing it in my temporary register called as Y. So since I am storing or I am writing to that register, so the signal that has been enabled is in signal. So R1 out to Y register, that is, I am moving the contents from R1 register to Y register. Next, now I have fetched the R1 contents. Now I need to fetch out with R2 contents. So I am fetching out it R2 out. Why? Because I need to read that data. So my output signal is been enabled. So R2 out comma select Y. So here in the MUX, recall the organization of your internal processor, that is to your single common bus you have a multiplexer MUX, and that will be gets connected to your ALU, isn't it? So to my register Y, so this Y will be sent as an input for an A and B, isn't it? Recall the diagram which has been previously written. So now I have fetched the contents of R1 and I have stored in my RY register, isn't it? So now why I am enabling the select Y means because my contents is being stored, that is R1 content is being stored in Y register. So to my multiplexer MUX, I am enabling the Y input. Why? Because I am enabling the select Y because that input will be fed to my ALU as an input A. So that is why I enabled the select Y signal, that is select Y and perform add operation. Why? Because that R1 content is being sent through Y register, and for input B, the R2 content, that is R2 out, will be directly sent by the processor to your ALU. So R1 content is sent through Y register and R2 content has been sent directly by the processor through the input B of your ALU. So now I got my R1 contents. Your processor has sent directly my R2 contents. Now what is the operation I need to follow between A and B? That is your addition operation. Fine. So I am performing the addition operation. After that, I am storing that result into my temporary register called as Z. So since I am writing that contents to that register, I have and written it as Z in. From my temporary register, again I am going to store it in my again the general purpose register R2. Isn't it? So from Z, I will be sending it to my processor bus and then it will be sent to my nth general purpose, any one of the general purpose register. That is, now here I am used is, here is the destination register is R2. So I need to store the result back to my R2 register itself. So I will be erasing the contents which was been previously stored and I will be storing now the result into this register. Sorry, I will be storing in my R3 register. Fine. So I will be sending the data from my Z register. So that is why I have written it as Z out. So I will be moving the contents from my Z register to an another general purpose register called as R3. So that is why I have written the control signal here it as in. So I have enabled the input of my R3 register. Here I have enabled the output of my Z register. Fine. This is how I will be performing the arithmetic or logical operation by enabling the corresponding input and output of an particular registers that is being involved in the operations. Fine. Clear how the operations is being carried out? Yes. That will be carried out in a three simple steps. For your example, add R1 and R2, store the result in R3 means I am taking the contents of R1 and I am storing into a temporary register called as Y. Next, what I am doing? I am again fetching the second operand, that is R2. R2 I have fetched, that is directly I have sent by the processor and I have enabled the select Y signal. Why? To get the R1 content, and then I will be performing the add operation. The R1 content is being sent to ALU through an input A, that is through my multiplexer MUX, and I have received that contents as an input to my ALU as an A input, and B input, that is the contents of R2, is being received by an B input, that is directly by the processor, and here the ALU is responsible to perform an addition operation. After carrying out that operation, I will be storing it in the result in another temporary register called as Z. So that is why I have enabled the input of the Z register. In the third step, what I am going to carry out is, I am placing the contents of Z register to an general purpose register called as R3. Why? Because it has been specified in my instruction and I already told I would be not... this will be not being directly specified the in the registers Y, Z and another temporary register temp. So that is why I will be moving the contents from Z register to R3 register. So I am enabling the output of Z registers and input of R3 register so that the result gets stored in your R3 register. This is how the steps you will be following to perform your arithmetic and logical operations. Fine. So in the next operation or the next sequence you will be going to learn is your, that is the third step or the third sequence, is fetching the contents from a particular memory location and storing into an data register or a particular general purpose register. So what is the sequence of steps that you will be followed to fetch the contents from a memory location and store it in a particular register, that you will be going to learn in your next class. So we shall meet up in your next class. Thank you all.